her contribution to the assembly was quite significant because she was the first Dalit woman to be elected to the Constituent Assembly and the only Dalit woman, in fact. She belonged to the Puliya community and she was one of the first women to wear an upper cloth. She was one of the first women within a community to earn a degree. Puliya community women were traditionally not allowed to wear an upper cloth. They could just wear beads to cover themselves up and they had to give way to upper community men or women. They were not allowed to walk in front of them or raise their heads in front of them. And she kind of broke that barrier too by being one of the first women to wear an upper cloth. It was quite significant because it kind of set the tone for the women who came after her, and she made tremendous strides for women within a community and changed the language in which they spoke and which they were spoken about during her time period. One of her primary arguments was that there should not be any reservation for Dalits in independent India, and any help for them should come through an economic upliftment rather than a social upliftment or a political upliftment, and only an economic, true economic upliftment can truly bring them to the forefront. And that was one of the things that she was quite disappointed about in the assembly too, that they went ahead and made reservation a part of the constitution. And in fact, she lived long enough to see reservation go well beyond the 10-year mark that it was originally planned for within the constitution. And it's quite significant because in that way she went both against Ambedkar and Gandhi in some sense, because she didn't think that their ideas of social or political upliftment would really bring benefit to the masses as much as an economic upliftment. And I think she truly believed that in an independent socialist India that would be possible a lot more. It would have been a little bit of a disappointment because the constitution, once it was eventually passed, it didn't go as far as these women had hoped. And you know, these were people who had walked with suffragettes in England, who had talked about equal pay, equal treatment in the workplace, and equal treatment in the political arena even before independence. And that conversation didn't seep in through the constitution post independence and post republic was something that they would have all been disappointed in. She had exactly one session in the Constituent Assembly before she left to Russia to serve as India's ambassador to Moscow. One of the more interesting things that she brought to the assembly was to try and look at the constitution and to try and frame the constitution in a way that would inform the world the direction that India was planning to take. She actually went because Gandhi encouraged her to go and talk about human rights and specifically how India was changing the conversation on human rights in the forum. It was quite interesting because this was a conversation that had happened many times before within India itself. The idea of how Britain can talk about Germany under Hitler, or how they can talk about German colonizing Europe when they were forcing the subjects of within India and within other colonial countries to fight for a cause. Many of them feel that were not their fight, basically. And her argument was basically that, you know, you should give them the dignity of at least representing themselves before forcing them to fight for under an imperial flag. And it made quite a stir at that point because no one had stepped up to talk about Britain or to cast aspersions on Britain's role in Second World War in that language, and I think her voice mattered a lot within that context. Post her husband's death, because of the property loss at that time, post her husband's death, she and her daughters kind of lost everything that they owned, and all her property and all her all the money that they earned went to the next of kin, the male kin, which was her husband's brothers. And she had fight for it, and there was a court case that shaped Nehru's ideas on women's rights post marriage and what kind of rights women should have. And I think that kind of in spilled through during the Hindu Code of Bill arguments too. She she was the person responsible for changing the wording in the UN Declaration of Human Rights from human rights for men to human rights for all people. So you could in essence say that she had the idea of women's rights or human rights well before Clinton made that argument in China.
It is time for us to say here in Beijing and for the world to hear that it is no longer acceptable to discuss women's rights as separate from human rights.
One of the more brilliant things about Hansa Mehta and the women she served with in the All India Women's group was that they had prepared a charter for women's rights very early on, and it essentially asked for equal pay, equality at the workplace, equal treatment of women in society, and they had set the tone for abolishing dowries, and the Sardar Act was put in place by them quite early. The interesting part about the women's charter that they prepared at AIWC was that a lot of it eventually went on to shape the ideas of the people who were writing the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights. She was part of the subcommittee for drafting the Hindu Code Bill, and given her experience in AIWC, where they had already talked about abolishing dowry and talking about widow remarriage and talking about abolishing the child marriage, she wanted these things to be incorporated. And in fact, she was part of a group of women who believed that uniform civil code would serve the purpose a lot better than separate codes for different religion. And the Hindu Code Bill, one of the things that she was critical about was that, you know, it didn't go far enough. She wanted a uniform civil code, and that was one of the things that she clashed with Nehru and quite a few other people within the Constituent Assembly. It would behoove the country to declare a uniform civil code to show its dedication to how it was willing to treat its people equally and on equal footing, all men and women. And she thought a uniform civil code would actually help do that better. But Nehru, in all his wisdom, and Ambedkar for that matter, didn't think that it would go very far at that point, or more importantly, they thought it would raise a whole lot of other issues given how divided the country was at that time on religious grounds. So they thought it would be better handled a little later. There was no record of how they eventually came to see the constitution, or if they thought the constitution achieved as much, but I think that was one of her most significant contributions towards this. She started movements that would encourage women to be a lot more than just subservient fighters for freedom. She was part of the Bengal movements which demanded greater visibility of women within the freedom movement itself. She was the only woman member from Bengal to be elected to the Constituent Assembly. She resigned almost immediately in protest of the partition, at a time when women's magazines were talking about how they could support their men and how they could protest through the non-cooperation movement. She started a magazine called the Jayashri Patrika, which specifically aimed at not doing all these things that these women magazines were asking them to. She wanted to talk to the women about politics. She wanted to talk to them about how they could contribute to the politics of the country at that point. She and her husband were both members of the forward block that Subhash Chandra Bose had started, and it was part of chain of movements within Bengal that, you know, that kind of spurred more women into action and spurred more women into direct political movement against the British at that point. There were many firsts in her life too. She was one of the first women to get a degree. In fact, one of the two women who joined the Dhaka University, and they had to hold special classes in the evening because there were no other women. It was a men's only college. She was also one of the only women to get elected to Sri Sangha, which was a predominantly male bastion. And she changed the language of protests and freedom movements within Bengal and within Calcutta specifically by her activism.
I'm
Malati Devi Chowdhury. And I think she made a greater impact at the local level than she would have at as part of the debates. There were parallel movements during the independence struggle, and one of it was independence for the country and freedom from Britain and its policies that people like Nehru and Patel were fighting for. And on the other movement was at the more lower level, where people like Malati Devi were fighting for women, tribals and Dalits and their rights and their position in an eventually in an independent India, and what would they gain and what would they lose once India gained independence. And I think she made a greater impact at the local level than she would have at as part of the debates. One of her letters that she had written mentioned that she didn't feel that she fit in with the assembly members. In the presence of people like Nehru, Ambedkar, Patel, Durgabai Deshmukh and such, she felt like a high school student sitting in the back benches and trying to be a part of the debate. And she didn't think that her voice would have been that significant a contribution to the constitution. She despised the lack of originality in the constitution. She thought given the kind of intellectual minds that were occupying the hall, there should have been a lot more original thinking. She was working at Naukali and she was also working for the tribal groups in Tripura. And she very actively worked for their upliftment, for better treatment for them and better rights for them in an independent India.